This glaze may look like a completely normal glossy glaze, but this glaze has a secret. That's it! It glows in the dark. We'll show you why this glaze works and how to make it today in the workshop. Now, how do I turn the lights back on? No, that wasn't it. Oh, there we go. Hey everybody, I'm Rose and welcome to Ceramic Materials Workshop. Glow-in-the-dark glazes are one of those things that always seem impossible, but this glaze is very real. It's been fired in a kiln and it does glow in the dark, but there's a catch and we'll talk about that in a bit. We first came across this glaze in Inseca 2003 in San Diego. It was my husband Matt and I's first Inseca together. We were young, dumb, covered in clay dust. We were outside sitting next to a fountain in the beautiful California sun when somebody walked up to us and handed us a test tile and told us to look at it in the dark. When we got inside, we found that it glowed in the dark. It was so cool. Well, we lost that original test tile, but we remembered what the website stamped on the back was something like glowingglaze.com. And the website is now gone, but we found it using the internet Wayback Machine, and it is indeed called Glows, the glow-in-the-dark ceramic glaze. The website doesn't say much, and it looks like it shut down in 2005. But it does confirm everything we found out about these glazes. Years later, we had some students ask about it, so we went to the workshop to figure out how to do it, and we cracked the code. To do that, we have to talk about what makes things glow in the dark. It is not radioactive. Although, I'm sure Matt would like that. Although, a cat has made a pretty effective nightlight since we started this project. Don't worry, we'll take her to the vet. Anyway, there are different types of glow-in-the-dark materials, or photoluminescence, as the geekerati, like my husband Matt would call it. Hey. What that means is that it contains a material that will absorb light and then reflect it back over time. Now, there are three major ways to create luminescence. The first is chemiluminescent, which relies on the interaction of two chemicals, and that's what makes glow sticks work. Inside the tubes are two liquids, one in the soft outer plastic tube, second in a thin glass tube. And when you bend the outer tube, the glass vial breaks, the two mix together and create a chemical reaction, which is bright, but once the chemical reaction is done, so is the glowing. The next reason why things glow in the dark is called radioluminescence, which does rely on radioactivity and is incredibly toxic. Have you ever heard of the Radium Girls? In the early 1900s, it was discovered that radium glowed in the dark. And at the time, watches couldn't be seen at night without lights. So the Radium Luminescent Material Corporation developed a radium paint called Undark, great name, and it was applied to watch hands and faces so they could be read at night. Applying the paint was a delicate work and had to be done by hand. This led to around 4,000 women being employed as radium girls, hand painting the watches. They used very fine tipped brushes that they would often lick to refine the points, which led to many women consuming large amounts of radium. Because of this, dozens of painters died, including the inventor of the paint. And many of those that survived had health outcomes that were often worse than what we see in horror movies. If you want to hear more about the story of the Radium Girls, check out this great video by Joe Scott. It's a very tragic story, and my professional advice is to avoid radioluminescent materials. It's true we can use some radioactive materials in ceramics, like uranium, which is a fabulous colorant, but it doesn't glow in the dark, and that's a story for another day. The last is photoluminescence, which is what we use in our glow-in-the-dark glaze. Photoluminescent materials have a chemistry that absorbs the light. The materials that we use are called phosphors. These phosphors need to be charged with light, whether it comes from the sun, lights in your house, or even an ultraviolet or UV light like we have here. Black lights are the best because they are concentrated UV light, which is the most intense way to charge the phosphors. Photoluminescence will fade over time, but after you re-expose them to light, especially UV light, they'll shine again. And that's the first secret of our glow-in-the-dark glaze. It actually uses a fairly standard glow-in-the-dark powder called europium dope strontium aluminate. And that's a mouthful. Now, there are two common types of photoluminescent colorants in the world: europium dope strontium aluminate and zinc sulfide. The amazing thing about europium dope strontium aluminate is that it can survive some lower temperatures of a kiln. On the other hand, zinc sulfide can't even survive the lowest firing temperatures. You can buy europium dope strontium aluminate on the internet. We got this from eBay and it works great. Nothing special about the material, we just bought europium dope strontium aluminate, and I swear Matt added that so I would stumble on it, as a normal glow-in-the-dark powder. And it could be used for paint, ink, candles, anything really you can imagine. It's not specifically for ceramics. But here's the catch: the firing temperature. Yes, the powder can be fired in a kiln, but the temperature needs to be low. No, not low fire. Keep lowering your expectations. Even lower. Lower still. Think the reality of that picture of the ice cream tree versus what actually comes out of the box. For this glaze to work, you have to keep your firing temperature at cone 08 or lower. And that is low. Cone 08 is 942 degrees Celsius, and that's a bigger complication than you may think. The hardest part about developing this glaze wasn't finding the glow-in-the-dark powder, it was making a glaze that would melt effectively at such a low temperature. You can get that low by using materials like lead, but we would never recommend you use a lead glaze. There are very good reasons why lead glazes have been removed from ceramic art. It's just not worth the health risks. We can't even use a traditional material like feldspars. They don't even come close to melting that low, and some materials are even worse. Materials like whiting have CO2 that gas off at low temperatures. This isn't a problem with higher temperature glazes, as that occurs before the glaze starts melting. But when you need the melting to be done by cone 08, you don't have that luxury, as the glaze melting takes place over the last 100 degrees of the firing, which means you get a bubbly, foamy mess. Although, if you're looking for a bubbly, foamy glaze that glows, it's actually pretty easy to do. But to get a good melt, we found a base that we're pretty happy with, and we wanted a nice, smooth glaze. Now, I know a lot of you are gonna be disappointed that this glaze is not going to work at cone 6 or cone 10, but that's the way the cookie crumbles. I wasn't kidding about that temperature. These glow-in-the-dark powders literally cannot withstand any hotter temperatures. This is exactly the same glaze fired to cone 06, and I know it looks like I'm only holding one tile, but there are in fact two glazes here. And they're from the same glaze batch. I just dipped two tiles, one I fired at 08 and the other at 06. And 06 just destroyed the colorant. The color effect is completely and utterly gone. And that's only 46 degrees C hotter. Any higher temperatures than cone 08 kills this glaze dead. And that's the sad reality of this glaze. You're gonna have to take up a fight with a glow-in-the-dark chemist. Maybe someday someone will find a glow-in-the-dark powder that can go higher temperature, but as far as we know right now, this is as high as it goes. The trick was to get a glaze that melts that low, which took a lot of testing. We know that we would have needed a glaze with a substantial amount of boron, but even getting enough boron was a challenge. FRIT 3124, which is designed to be a cone 04 glaze all on its own. It doesn't need anything else to melt smooth and beautiful. Wouldn't fully melt at coat 08. The temperature is that much more extreme. So we had to bring out the big guns. $3195 is one heck of a frit. One, it's designed to be a glaze entirely on its own. And that's the trick of a lot of frits that we use. Many are designed to be a glaze with nothing else added. This is how 3124 works. 90% 3124 and 10% kaolin make a perfect cone 04 glossy glaze. And that's all it needs. The frit has a perfect amounts of silica, alumina, sodium, calcium, and boron. Everything that we would expect in a normal glaze, just in one material. For the hardcore nerds out there, 3124 has 0.55 boron via UMF, and 3195 has a whopping 1.10 boron via UMF. And if you have no idea what I said, join us online at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com and we'll teach you everything you ever wanted to know about how glazes and clay bodies work. Our glaze is really just pure 3195 and some clays to keep the glaze from hard panning. That's it. The base glaze is incredibly simple. 3195, 95%, EPK, 5%, bentonite, 2%, and glow-in-the-dark powder, 10%. As far as colorant percentages, we found that 10% is just right. Less than that and the color's not as bold, more colorants and you don't see much benefit, and you're just throwing away money on the colorant. And we like 60% water for this glaze, and that's it. So what does that mean? It's time for a batching montage. And here we have it, our perfectly lovely glossy glaze that glows in the dark. You can use it on sculpture, pots, or make ceramic versions of the stars that you had on your ceiling when you were a kid. But just make sure they're well secured or they turn into glow in the dark ninja stars falling on you in the middle of the night. Or just maybe, how about holiday ornaments? That would be much better. You can put it on pots, but know any clay fired to those temperatures is gonna be extremely porous, which is bad news for function. So I would keep it to decorative items like these stars. So fire away and we hope to see you make something great with it. Thanks for stopping by the workshop, everyone. If you found this video helpful, please subscribe, give us a like, and show us your glazes on social media. Ceramic Materials Workshop only exists because of the support of the community. Please consider joining us on Patreon, where we have tons of extra educational content. Or if you really want to understand how your glazes and clay bodies work, take one of our online classes or workshops at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com. And we'll see you next time in the workshop.